Hi, my name's Scott Thornbury, and I want to just talk a little bit about the background to the dogma, also known as teaching unplugged language teaching approach, which I kind of jointly developed about 20 years ago as a teacher trainer working in a language school in Spain and committed to the communicative approach, which, if you recall, it's basic. Foundational principle was, in Dick Allwright's terms, if communication is the aim of language learning, then it should be the major element in the process. And what I and my teacher training colleagues were noticing that in many of the classes that we're watching of our trainees, both pre-service and in-service, particularly in-service, there wasn't actually a great deal of communication happening. These classes reflected this observation by Michael Legutke and Howard Thomas around about the same time. They said, in spite of trendy jargon in textbooks and teachers' manuals, that is, references to the communicative approach, very little is actually communicated in the second language classroom. And they go on, learners do not find room to speak as themselves, to use language in communicative encounters, to create text, to stimulate responses from fellow learners or to find solutions to relevant problems. And this was very much, as I say, the kind of observation I was making in the classes that I was watching. And it occurred to me and my colleagues that perhaps one of the problems here was that the teachers were, in a sense, over-resourced. They had so many resources, bearing in mind this was 20 years ago, pre the massive explosion of internet and digital resources. Nevertheless, there was a lot of use of course books, a lot of use of worksheets, a lot of activity, but not a lot of actual interactivity. And if you think about the traditional classroom, whether a language classroom or any kind of classroom, there's this kind of three-way distinction between teach the materials and the learners. And traditionally, at least, the kind of vector of the path of transmission, if you like, is via the materials. Classically, when the teacher says, "Good morning, class, open your books, turn to page 56, Jose, what's the answer to number one?" kind of thing. And so, what we were trying to do is to kind of open up that other route, which is between the teacher and the learners, the direct route, if you like, with language learning taking place not via the materials, but between the teacher and the learners, and between the learners themselves. And it was about this time, coincidentally, that I happened to be aware of a film movement that was quite popular called the dogme 1995 group. And this was a group of Scandinavian filmmakers who produced a number of films which were committed to the principles that were in contrast to the kinds of big budget high-tech movies produced by Hollywood. What they were trying to do is what they called rescue filmmaking and return it back to less techniquey films and more human films, if you like. And they drafted a manifesto which was circulated, and that's where I first saw it. It was actually in the cinema in Barcelona. And that to another was to make films according to these rules. You had to, for example, shoot the film on location, not in some big studio. And that the sound should not be produced apart from the images. So that is to say, if you wanted music in the film, then somebody needs to pick up a guitar, play the guitar. It's not added afterwards. And of course, the camera must be handheld. Now, this was a provocative movement, which, as I say, it sought to rescue filmmaking and in their own words, to restore the joy of filmmaking. And I saw an analogy here between the dogma film movement and what I was witnessing happening, or what I wanted to happen in the classrooms of the trainee teachers. I was working with. And so I propose in an article, a kind of provocative article that came out in 2000, that we needed a similar movement in language teaching. We need to rescue language. We need to retrieve the basic principles of the communicative approach. Remember that, you know, it should be based on communication. Communication should be the major activity in the classroom. And I said, echoing the dogma film movement, I drafted a manifesto of my own, which was, again, a bit facetious, if you like, deliberately provocative. And I said things like teaching should be done using only the resources that teachers and students bring to the classroom, and whatever happens to be in the classroom. And the effect of this was that a number of people got in touch with me who were similarly frustrated, I think, by the kind of materials overload that they were witnessing in their schools, their work environments. And so we formed a discussion group online to share ideas about how this kind of these principles could be realized in actual classroom practice in a variety of contexts around the world. And it was called the Dogma Discussion Group after the filmmakers. And our kind of mission statement was that we are looking for ways of exploiting the learning opportunities offered by the raw material of the classroom. That is the language that emerges from the needs, interests, concerns, and desires of the people in the room, the raw material, the bare necessities. So this attracted a great deal of comment and discussion and, you know, counter discussion, people who didn't agree, etc. But it was a very lively discussion post. And after about 8 or 9 years of that, Luke Meddings, a co-founder, if you like, of the Dogma movement, and I decided to kind of gather together all these threads of these arguments to state more explicitly what dogma represented and some of the sort of iconic classroom activities that were associated with it. So we wrote this book called Teaching Unplugged. And again, this was an attempt to change the title, with dogma having negative associations, of course, in many languages, and rename it Teaching Unplugged. And it was through that writing that book that we pared down the actual principles of dogma or Teaching Unplugged to three. First of all, dogma is about teaching that is conversation driven. It is driven not by the textbooks, not by the materials, but by the conversations of the people in the room. And therefore it is materials light. And very importantly, dogma is about teaching that focuses on emergent language. That is to say, the language that is focused on is not pre-selected. It's not in a kind of grammar syllabus. It comes out of the conversations. The only thing I would change now in that description is change conversation to text driven, because of course it's not just about speaking. It's also about producing written text too, particularly in contexts where people need to improve their writing for academic purposes or whatever. But basically those are the three fundamental principles. And a lot of it borrowed, its pedagogy, if you like, was borrowed from task-based learning. If you remember, task-based learning is a kind of reaction to the traditional presentation approach to language teaching, or the so-called PPP approach, that is presentation, practice and production. You present a grammar item, you practice it, and then the students are expected to produce it in some kind of freer activity. And that is this kind of, that's the standard, if you like, the default setting for much language teaching that takes place and is represented in a lot of the course books that we were using then and still are using now. So I said, to contrast this with a task-based approach, I said a presentation approach is based on the premise that there is something that the learners don't know. Yeah, it could be an item of grammar, for example, the present perfect continuous. Something that the learners don't know, and the approach attempts to fill those holes in the knowledge. By contrast, a task-based approach starts from the assumption that there is something that the learners can do. Yeah? They can do stuff with language in their first language, and maybe to a certain extent in their target language, the language that they're learning. They can do things with language. They can tell a story. They can apologize. They can complain. They can make a request, etc. So this starts from that assumption that there's things that they can do, and it attempts to empower them with the means to do this more effectively, to give them the means, the linguistic means, predominantly, to be able to realize these kinds of meanings, the things that they want to do. So the task-based cycle, if you like, is very much starting with a task, which then they get feedback on the task, suggestions of how to do it better, they repeat the task, and so on, so on, so on. So that was very much the kind of pedagogical model, if you like, that underpinned the dogma teaching unplugged approach. The only difference was between dogma and teaching and task-based learning that it attempted to do that using minimal materials. More recently, the dogma approach has received kind of theoretical support from a set of theories which are generally known as usage-based learning. Usage-based approaches emphasize how language is learned from participatory experience. Participating in experiences of processing language, understanding language, processing it during here and now, real embodied interaction in social and cultural context. In other words, language in the real world takes place in social and cultural context, and we learn language by participating in the experience of those language exchanges. We learn our first language, and arguably we learn or perfect our second language. So usage-based theories have been, in a sense, although they're more recent, they have in a sense validated some of the basic principles of dogma approach. The dogma approach being that you experience language use in the classroom context, but a classroom context which attempts to simulate the kind of communication that takes place in the real world. And through that exposure and use of language in these kinds of activities, that language learning develops. Of course, not on its own, and this is where the teacher is important, because the teacher takes the language, gives feedback to the task, and the students take on that feedback on board, so and the cycle continues. So I hope that that has given you a clearer idea of what the principles are, at least the underpinning the dogma stroke teaching unplugged approach. Thank you.